Blog Talk Radio.
See you and me riding like Bonnie and Clyde, rolling 95, burning down 149, yeah. Looking for the law while I push my luck. Riding shotgun like it ain't no thing. Turn the radio off so the girl can sing right. Pull into the party like y'all was some. Night is bottoms up. Throw it on down. Life is quite a little country tangled up. Drop the tailgate on your truck. Find a keg and fill your cup. Oh, kick it on back. Pretty little mama looking at you like that. I gotta tip my hat. Never thought a country song make you move like that, yeah. And she's doing any days you do, girl. She got you tapping on the boy show. Hey, Dom, check this out. Man, it's how them girls do it in the dirty south, yeah. She have you on the knee, can I marry you? If the night is bottoms up, throw it on down. Rock this quiet little country town to get up. Drop a tailgate on your truck. Find a keg and feel your cup. Oh, kick it on back. Pretty little mama looking at you like that. Make you wanna slide on in like, girl, what's up? Tonight is bottoms up. Get em up. Tonight is bottoms up. Drinks up high, everybody feeling alright. Damn right, 'cause tonight is bottoms up. Throw it on down, rock this quiet little country town to get up. Drop a tailgate on your truck. Find a keg and fill your cup. Oh, kick it on back. Pretty little mama looking at you like that. Take you on the slide on it like a whistle.
Ladies and gentlemen, that was Bottoms Up by the one and only Brantley Gilbert, who holds a very, very special place in my heart. He helped my granddaughter see how beautiful she really was before she died a couple of years ago, and I promote that young man at every opportunity. This is Off the Chain. I am your host, Yvonne Mason. My guest tonight, for whatever reason, did not show up. But you know what? I know how to make lemonade out of lemons. And since tonight is the debut show of Married with Secrets, which I will be on the Investigation Discovery Channel in an hour, I'm going to take this opportunity to talk about the book that particular segment is taken from. But first, I want to say thank you to Australia. You guys are my biggest listening audience, with 98% of y'all listening to this show, and I'm so grateful to you for that. And in turn, I want to promote one of your blues bands, the Teskey Brothers. These guys are absolutely magnificent. If you roll up Johnny Lang and Eric Clapton and B.B. King and Otis Redding, and a few others, Robert Johnson, and put them in a nice big tight package, you would have the Teskey brothers. These guys should be on the Big Easy instead of down in Australia, because they sound like they need to be performing somewhere on Bourbon Street during Mardi Gras. So if you haven't heard them yet, please go look up their music. It's the Teskey Brothers. They're on Reverbination. They're on iTunes. They're everywhere. And they're also on Facebook. So go and look them up. They're on YouTube. And because this show is y'all's show, it's not my show. Like I said, I could sit here all day and talk, and y'all would not have the impact that I have because y'all listen and send people to me. Oh, y'all have helped this show grow exponentially, and I am so grateful. Between my guest and the audience and just all of you, this morning when I ran my numbers, we're at 87,635 listeners just on this show, not with all the podcasts, but just on this show, we're almost to 88,000 listeners. And when you add all the podcasts, this show turns out on it. It's on iTunes and YouTube and TuneIn Radio and FM.com and SoundCloud, MixCloud, Spreaker, Podcast Garden, and Podcast.com. We have reached a collective. We have reached 109,000 plus listeners. So, ladies and gentlemen, I want to thank you all so, so much. Y'all are the absolute best. And yeah, we occasionally have bumps in the road, and for whatever reason, my guest doesn't show up. But you know what? I don't let that bother me. I carry on with the show because the show is important. It is very important. It gives people a platform. And tonight is especially important because tonight I am going to talk about the reason that I am on Investigation Discovery for the second time. This will be the fourth time that I have appeared on television, twice on Investigation Discovery, once in France and once in England. And in my career as a writer, I just had a friend of mine say, everyone would love to know what started you out as a writer and as a host of this wonderful show. Thank you, Stephen. You are wonderful. What started me out as a writer is I communicate better with the written word than I do the spoken word. I can get my thoughts down. I can get the way that I feel. And I can get people lost in a story better than I can verbalize a story. So I started writing simply as a way to be heard. And when I was in my late 30s, early 40s, I wanted to worry about my brother, who is mentally and physically challenged. And because I knew there would be a time in our lives when none of us would be around, we would all be gone, and there would be no one to remember Stan. And Stan was born at a time when life was not easy for those who are unique. I don't say he's challenged, he's unique, because in this world, ladies and gentlemen, every one of us is challenged without fail. We all have a flaw. I live in a right-handed world. I stutter when I get tired. I can't get my thoughts to come forward when I am trying to carry on a communication. When I'm tired, they get stuck, and I start doing my own version of charades, and people that know me have to figure out what I'm trying to say and translate. So my brother taught me that it's okay, and that we as human beings are capable of more than we believe we are. And that if we choose to succeed, no matter what it is that our dream is, we can be successful. The title of the book about Stan is Dreamcatcher: Failure Was Never an Option. And failure was never an option with him. With whatever Stan wanted to do, Stan set out to do it. And sure, there were times that he might not reach the top of that dream, but he didn't fail because he tried. He went after that dream and went as far as he could. So he succeeded. Well, he taught me these things. He taught me that it is important to succeed in whatever it is we do in life. If we want to be a mother and a domestic engineer, And ladies and gentlemen, in layman's term, that is housewife, and there's nothing wrong with that. It is an honorable position. If you wanted to be the president, whatever you wanted to be, you could do it. And succeed at it, even if you are flawed, which we all are. So in the late 1880s, early 1990s, I started writing Stan's story. And I wrote it out in longhand, ladies and gentlemen. I didn't have a computer. I didn't have a typewriter. So I wrote the original manuscript in longhand, and I still have that manuscript. That manuscript is very important to me in its original form because it reminds me that there's no excuse for not doing that which you want to do. I could have complained and said, I don't have this, I don't have that, I don't have the other. But I didn't. I took a pencil, a pen, paper, and I wrote out the manuscript. It took me 30 years almost to get that manuscript in printed form. I was turned away at every turn. People turned me away. They rejected me. Publishing houses laughed at me, basically. I could wallpaper my house with the rejection letters. But I refused to be denied. His story needed to be told. So what I did is I waited until I moved to Florida in 2006. And then in 2007, I took my destiny in my own hands. I made it work for me. And what I did is I decided I would be an indie publisher. Oh, yeah, I was laughed at. I was told that indie publishers were not really authors, that we were not that credible, we were not that important, that we were too stupid to do good work. You know what, ladies and gentlemen, that didn't stop me. Because when I wrote that book and published it, I turned around and wrote another one, and then another one, and then another one. And while I was doing that, my husband, who was the chief investigator for the 19th Judicial Circuit, told me a story. And the story was about Gerard Schaefer. And he was Florida's first serial killer. He was before Bundy. He was before Danny Rollin. He was before the Son of Sam. But at the time, law enforcement did not talk to each other. There was no such things as forensics. There was no such thing as CSI agents. There was no such thing as the NCIS or the NCIC. There was no such thing as putting similar deaths together to figure out that one person might have. There was no FBI profiling for serial killers at all. What happened? Gerard Schaefer was a Martin County deputy. He had been fired from the Wilton Manors Police Department. He forged a letter, stationery from Wilton Manors, signed by his chief. He forged his chief's name. He forged the letter, and he took it to the Martin County Sheriff's Department here in South Florida. He was hired based on his own recommendation. Because at the time, law enforcement went on a code of honesty and honor. So Schaefer was hired. Unbeknownst to the sheriff, Robert Crowder, Schaefer had been killing since 1969. Nobody knew it. Actually, been killing since 1966. Nobody knew it. Because Schaefer knew the area. He knew the remoteness at the time because South Florida was still mostly mangroves and swamp. And so Schaefer knew where to hide the bodies. And what Schaefer would do is he would take these girls and he would tell them that he was going to take them and show them things. He was going to be their best friends. He was going to do this. He was going to do that. And he was going to offer them these jobs. He pretended to be somebody that he wasn't. And he killed in pairs. And during this time period, ladies and gentlemen, it was nothing for girls to hitchhike. This was the time of free love and the age of Aquarius and all that. So it was nothing for these girls to hitchhike. And he would pick them up and he would take them to remote areas and he would gag them, hang them, and put them either on the mangrove roots or on a bottom of a 5-gallon bucket and make them stand there. And he would torture them mentally, physically, emotionally, until he got tired of doing that. And then he would shoot them in the back of the head. Then he would bury them. And if that wasn't enough, he would go back and commit necrophilia with them. Some of these girls, a couple of these girls were young as 8, 9, and 14. Some of them were in their 20s. Some of them he knew personally. Lee Hanlon will be one of the girls that we talk about tonight on the ID channel. She lived next across the street from him. He knew her. He knew her personally. He would watch her undress at night. And he would tell his friends that she wanted him to kill her. He really believed he was doing all of these girls a favor, that they really wanted to die because they were all whores and drug addicts and runaways, and they all deserved to die. If he saw a certain type of female walking down the street, he would pick them up. After I published the book Silent Scream, which tells the girl's story, and ladies and gentlemen, if you're into a feel-good story or if you're into what their favorite pet was or their favorite color, who their boyfriend was or who their best friend was, you're not going to get it in Silent Scream. And I have gotten some pretty ugly feedback because it's not a feel-good story. This book is a clinical, raw, to-the-point police story. It is not feel-good, poor, pitiful victim, poor, pitiful criminal. No, this tells the raw, boned story of what happened to these girls. It is ugly. It is sickening. And it hurts. It hurt me so much that when I was researching this story, I did not sleep. Because these girls talk to me. Some of these girls, ladies and gentlemen, have never been found. Their families have never been able to move on because they were never found. The only reason that Schaefer got caught was because he picked up two girls from the Midwest and took them to a remote island here in South Florida, and they managed to get away. And when they managed to get away, he was locked up for 6 months for assault and kidnapping. When he went to court, when Schaefer went to court to face the charges, the judge only gave him 6 months because at the time, nobody knew these other girls had disappeared. The judge also gave him from September to January from September of 71 to January, from September of 72 to January of 73 to get his affairs in order and then report to the jail to serve his 6 months. From September of 73 to January of 72 until January of 73, Schaefer killed six more girls. In April of 1973, two of those six victims were found. again, over on Hutchinson Island. That was when my husband got involved, and the MO was so close to what the two girls who had gotten away experienced. They went and pulled search warrants and found evidence that linked Schaefer to even more murders. They found the evidence of the two girls' bodies at Schaefer's mother's house. To Schaefer, of course, he denied it. He never, ever, ever admitted to killing these girls. But what Schaefer did is he wrote killer fiction, which he said was just his imagination working overtime. They found the manuscript in his mother's house. But the manuscript, which I have a copy of the book, and I paired it with the evidence and the case files that I had on these girls, and it read word for word as to what happened to the girls in the case files. What Schaefer had done is he had written a journal of his crimes. Because with serial killers, ladies and gentlemen, you cannot get into the mind of a serial killer. Because every serial killer is different. Their mind works different. They profile their victims. They stalk their victims. They know the type of victim they're looking for. They also keep trophies because as they kill, it's a release for them. It's power. It's self-gratification. So they keep the trophies and they relive this crime over and over and over again. And that's what Schaefer did. That's why he wrote the stories. But also what happens, ladies and gentlemen, is as time goes on, the drug of choice, which is in Schaefer's case, was mutilation and murder and torture, high wears off. So they escalate. And they kill more frequently. And then they get sloppy. There's two different kinds of serial killers. There's a non-organized and then there's an organized. Schaefer was a very organized killer. And the only reason he got lost is he did get sloppy. The two girls that got away, he got sloppy. If he had not gotten caught, who knows how many more he would have killed. But as a general rule, he was very organized. But he escalated, and when he was put in jail for the 6 months for the two that got away, his anger was so bad that he killed six more girls, and he always killed in pairs. He killed six more girls in a 3 month period as fast as he could do it because of the anger, and he had lost the power that he had. The sad part, or one of the sad parts, is that some of these girls have never, ever been found and will never be found. The other sad part is the first two known kills that we know about that happened in 1966, there was a witness. But by the time the witness got to the police and told the police what she saw, Schaefer was gone. The other sad part is when Schaefer killed the little Deborah Lowe, he had integrated himself into the family. She was 14. And even after she disappeared, he kept visiting the family and wanting to know what they knew, wanting to know what they'd heard, wanting to know this, wanting to know that. When Schaefer was finally arrested for the murder of Susan Place and Georgia Jessup, and his picture was posted in all the papers, the family said, "That's the guy that kept coming to our house." But they knew him as somebody else. When Susan Place and Georgia Jessup disappeared, Schaefer had been in Susan Place's home. Susan's mother had met him. Susan's mother wrote down the tag number of the car that the girls left in, but she wrote it down wrong. Now, I know that some of you are saying, oh, but it can never happen to me. It can never happen to anybody I know. It can never happen to us because it just doesn't happen anymore. Ladies and gentlemen, let me tell you something. It can happen to anyone on any given day at any given time. Gerard Schaefer was a sociopath. He was a narcissistic sociopath. They do walk among us. They're in our families, they're our next door neighbors, they're our repair people. Some of them even go to church with us. We work with them. One must always be vigilant. One must always understand the risk we take, because you have to ask yourself, how well do you really know someone? On the show tonight, Married with Secrets, on the ID channel, in 33 minutes, ladies and gentlemen, the question is, how well did Schaefer's wife know him? He had already been killing young girls before he married his young wife. How well did police, the sheriff, Robert Crowder, know Gerard Schaefer when he hired him? He had already been killing since 1966. So we don't always know people like we think we do. And people do have secrets, and they do keep those secrets. So when you say, oh, I know so-and-so, so-and-so would never, ever, ever do something like that. Wrong. Schaefer was very charming, very charismatic, very good with the women. Even when he was in prison and he was flirting, and I use that term loosely, with the reporters that would go and visit him, they couldn't get enough of him because he would give them just enough to tease them. He would say, well, maybe I did, maybe I didn't, but if you'll come back and visit me and talk with me, I will read this to you. An FBI agent friend of mine, who has since died, wrote the full book. He created the profile department for serial killers. He wrote Schaefer several letters, and Schaefer wrote him back, and he played the cat and mouse game with this FBI agent. Offer up just tidbits and return for something that he wanted from the FBI. But he never would admit to what he did. But when he was in prison with Ted Bundy, he and Bundy talked. And he asked Bundy, he told Bundy that Bundy was a sloppy killer. And he asked Bundy how many kills he had done. And Bundy told him 33, and Schaefer says, well, I've got you beat. I've done 35. So we know he did at least between 9 and 35. In the book Silent Scream, I talk about 9 victims, the 9 victims that I know about. 3 of those will be on Married with Secrets tonight at 9 o'clock Eastern Standard Time. Lee Hanline, Belinda, and one more. I think it's Deborah Lowe. So 3 of those victims will be talked about. But even with an hour show, ladies and gentlemen, you're not going to get the full effect of the horror of what Gerard Schaefer did. Because after you take out all of the commercials, it's really only a 30-minute show. So go and watch this. And learn something, because the girls need their voice. That's why the book is called Silent Scream, because the girls are not silent anymore. They could only scream silently when they were gagged and hung and handcuffed They couldn't scream out while he was cutting them with knives and putting a gun to their head and doing things to them that was unspeakable. You cannot fathom it. And what he would tell them is, one of you make up your minds. Y'all decide between the two of you which of you is going to die and which of you is going to live, because one of you is going to die. He had no intentions of letting either one of them go. He was going to kill both of them. But he wanted them to think he was going to let one of them go. Because he was a manipulator. He was narcissistic. Nothing was ever his fault. It was always somebody else's fault. The girls made him do it. It was always their fault. He was a sociopath because he had no remorse. He had no feelings of guilt. It was all about his gratification, his power, his fulfillment. And to make matters worse, ladies and gentlemen, this man would go out into the woods. He would dress in women's underwear, and it's called autoerotic hanging. He would hang himself until he had an orgasm. And that escalated to kidnapping, torturing, and murdering, executing girls. Now think about that for just a minute. Your daughter goes off. She and a friend go off. And they never come home again. You think they're safe. Now this is before cell phones. This is before any internet that is like we have now. Landlines were still very prevalent. So your daughter goes off with a friend to the beach. She never comes home. You don't hear from her for months. And sadly, law enforcement at that time, because there were so many runaways, there were so many girls hitchhiking, they didn't actively look for them. Because they, in a couple of cases, the girls had run away from home two or three times before. They had a history of being runaways, so they didn't look for them. But this time she doesn't show back up. In Deborah Lowe's case, they had moved down here from West Virginia. And when the cops showed up, they said, oh, she's just homesick. She's gone back home. Really? She's 14 years old. Deborah Lowe's never been found. The family still hopes for the day that some part of her remains will be found. It's not fair to these families. It's not fair to the victims that the families cannot move forward, because you cannot, they say in law enforcement, close that chapter of your life. You never get over a death of a child. Never. That hole is always there. But for a child to just disappear and never, ever be found is the worst feeling in the world, because you cannot say goodbye to that child. You cannot move on with your life because you're always waiting for that child to walk back through the door. The mothers of one of Schaefer's victims still lives in the same house, still has the same phone number, still has her room the same. And when the reporter asks her why, she says, because I want to be here when she comes back. That's another victim that has never been found. So, ladies and gentlemen, I am asking you in 24 minutes, if you haven't already turned on the ID channel, turn on the ID channel. Watch this show. Go and purchase Silent Scream. Continue to give the girls their voice. They drive this train. I don't drive this train. When the girls want to be heard, they find a way to be heard. Channel has come to me twice. A production company out of England came to me. A production company out of France has come to me. A class of criminal justice majors was sent to me by their professor because I am the expert on Schaefer. I have all of the information. I have all of the research. I am the one that connected the dots. And my husband said when I started writing this, he said, Yvonne, nobody's interested in a 30-year-old murder. And later he said, I was so wrong, because they are. Continue to give my girl a voice. Yes, ladies and gentlemen, these girls are with me all of the time. All the time. Their families are friends with me on Facebook. They reach out to me all the time. We remember birthdays. We remember special moments in their lives. It is important to understand that we don't know what these girls would have been capable of if they had been allowed to live, if Schaefer had not so abruptly snuffed out their life like he was killing a bug. One of his victims was studying to be a nurse. Who knows what she would have accomplished in the nursing field? It is imperative that we know where our children are. It is imperative that people know where we are. If we're expected to be somewhere and we're running late, we need to let them know. It is imperative, ladies and gentlemen, that we are always cognizant of where we are, the environment we are in, and the people that we are around. Because even now, it will happen. The innocence of trusting cops was destroyed when Schaefer did what he did. Because he dressed as a cop to make his victims feel comfortable. He was a cop. He knew how to approach these vulnerable young women and convince them that he could help them sightsee or learn music or become CIA agents. The stories he told these women to lure them into his car will scare you. If it sounds too good to be true, it is. So no matter what you do in your life, remember, everyone has secrets. Some are more lethal than others. If you have a gut feeling that you don't trust someone, get away from them as fast as you can. And real quick, I have to play this commercial, and I will be right back with you.
Former Boston PD Captain Stanford Carter and his wife, forensic scientist Jill Seacrest, have decided to move to the Big Apple to accept positions with the New York branch of the FBI. Rookie agent Shania Deep Rose completes the trinity as they collide head-on with raging and rampant social, political, and economic unrest amid a string of murders that seem unrelated and may be serial, copycat, thrill, or hate-driven. As they struggle to understand the mind and thought process of the orchestrators, killers, and victims, the team begins to wonder, who's who. The line between black and white, superior and subordinate, right and wrong, and good and evil disappears as they are forced to reevaluate their own thoughts, feelings, and philosophies. Ultimately, every character must come to their own conclusions to these questions. Is justice ever more important than the law? Is playing God justifiable if it's for the greater good of all? Come along for the ride to see if Agent Carter will decide to stick to being a hunter or become judge, jury, and executioner instead. Find the answers to these questions when you read the new book, The Killing Collective. The Killing Collective is a character-driven story with big characters with depth. They're soul-searching in addition to the biggest case of the agents' careers. The Killing Collective, available on Amazon in both Kindle and paperback editions. Order your copy today.
That was the ad for The Killing Collective by my friend and fellow author, Gary Starter, who will be my guest tomorrow night. So join us tomorrow night at 8 o'clock time and listen to what Gary has to say. I'm going to play you a song now that a friend of mine who has been a guest on this show before, he is a musician and he writes his own music. His name is Ken Tucker. And he wrote this song. It's called The Killer's Mind. And ladies and gentlemen, it is absolutely the best way to almost end tonight's show. So before we close out the show, I want to play this song for you, and then I want to give you a few more things about Schaefer, and then we will close the show. And I want you all to go turn on ID channel and watch Married with Secrets, so that you will understand what happened. So hold on just a moment.
Ticking bomb thousand secrets are in its home. The empty hours, the restless nights, the living dead, that inner strife. Flooding rust, a building quake, a heart of stone, a heart of stone, a heart of stone.
That was A Killer's Mind by my friend Ken Tucker. He wrote that song, and that song fits Gerard Schaefer so well because he did have a heart of stone. He started killing small animals when he was just 12, 13 years old. Got kicked out of seminary school trying to be a priest. Got kicked out of college when he wanted to be a substitute teacher. Those were all areas where he would have been in contact with young women. They would have been perfect for him to prey on. He had a heart of stone, but yet now his victims have a voice. Please, ladies and gentlemen, please go and get the book Silent Scream. Please, it's downloadable on Kindle, on Nook, paperback. There's no reason not to continue to give these beautiful girls whose lives were snuffed out way too early. Give them their voice. Let them be heard. Tune in tonight in about 12 minutes on the Investigation Discovery Channel and watch Married with Secrets. This is so important. Not for me. I'm just their facilitator. I just gave them a voice. This is important to them and their families because, ladies and gentlemen, the victims were not just the girls whose lives he destroyed. The victims are also the families that carry the scars and the holes in their hearts where those girls will never be again. Schaefer not only destroyed those young girls, he shredded their families, their friends, their loved ones. Some of the parents died without ever knowing what happened. So please, ladies and gentlemen, continue to give these girls a voice. Go and get Silent Scream. Tune in tonight on the ID channel in 11 minutes. And watch Married with Secrets and watch at the cruelty and the nom de plume, the total lack of remorse, the total non-empathy, the total coldness of serial killer Gerard Schaefer. Help the families and the girls to be heard, to carry on their voice. And ladies and gentlemen, in closing, love your children, your wives, and your husbands enough that you always know where they are. Just love them enough to do that. Because you may say it'll never happen to me, but you don't ever know. I'm sure that these girls, when they were hitchhiking and walking up and down the road and going off with men that they barely knew, they never thought it would happen to them. And it did. And like I said, these girls are very special to me. Part of my soul. They are very important to me. So please give them the voice they deserve. Read their book. And I watched in exactly 9 minutes and 43 seconds. And with that, ladies and gentlemen, I am going to close the show so that you can go and watch, get ready to watch. If you can't watch it, at least TiVo it. And I thank you for listening. Tomorrow night at 9 o'clock Eastern Standard Time, author Gary Starter will be with me. At 8 o'clock Eastern Standard Time, I'm sorry, Gary Starter will be with me, and we will have another wonderful hour of Off the Chain. Don't just feel special, ladies and gentlemen, be special, because if you just feel special, you'll never be special. The difference between who you are today and who you want to be tomorrow is what you do today. So if you want to be somebody different tomorrow, change what you do today. Want to achieve greatness? Stop asking permission, because nobody's going to give it to you. Your smile is your logo. Your personality is your business card. And how you leave others feeling after having had an experience with you, ladies and gentlemen, there's your trademark. Real quick, if you want to feel good about yourself, go and join Miss Cece Chamberlain on Inside Your Life with Cece at www.podcast.com. It's a podcast full of thought-provoking interviews, motivational and inspirational to inspire others and lift up your soul with feel-good stories, conversations to strengthen your mind, body, and soul. Inspiration and motivation are so far and few between, and for many, it's tough days. However, Inside Your Life with CC podcast is the glimmer of hope in a world full of confusion, discouraging times, or just plain old tough days, and we all have them. CC's interviews will entertain you, uplift you, and bring absolutely the best out of the world. So, ladies and gentlemen, go and check out Miss CC Chamberlain with Inside Your Life with CC at www.podcast.com/InsideYourLifeWithCC. Till tomorrow night at 8 o'clock Eastern Standard Time, this is your host, Yvonne Mason, with Off the Chain, and we bid you adieu. Let's go see the 20.